So I'm giving you a year. Either give me something to read within a year or I can't help you. Wow. So I thought it would be ridiculous not to meet that deadline, and I did. I wrote The Sex Lives of African Girls to share.
Wow, The Sex Life of African Girls.
The Sex Lives of African Girls. And it's a juicier title.
No, but it's been described as a very, almost dark, indeed, some people have described it as a dark writer.
Oh, it is.
Do you deliberately set out to seem dark, or it just happens to be the way you write?
Well, I don't deliberately set out to do anything other than try to get the work done, meet the deadlines, and not default on my contract. but I know the writing is dark. It's true. I see that. I see that it's dark. But at the same time, very light. Very. I always joke. I think Ghana Must Go was funny.
Mm-hmm.
I find it a very. There are hugely devastating themes being considered, no doubt.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, sometimes when we read books about Africans, we have this attitude like, it's very serious. Like Africans are very serious. And I'm like, actually,
no.
We're kind of funny, dude.
But it's a serious book, actually.
Also.
It is.
But there are
the funny parts. Like even the man sleeping like cocoyam, for instance.
Yeah.
How can anyone sleep like cocoyam? When it takes me right from looking at a plant cocoyam. Like,
yeah, or Mr. Lanty the carpenter. Yeah. Dude, it's funny. I love that guy. It is a serious book, but I think that the beauty of fiction, the beauty of all art, is that you can handle heavy things lightly.
Mm-hmm. But it will seem to me as if you are on a journey of discovery from all the things you've written. It's almost as if you're still on a path to discovering yourself.
Always be.
Oh, you are.
I'll always be on a path to discovering myself.
But the story in Ghana Must Go, some say it's your story, but I say it's all of us. It's our story.
Bravo.
As a people.
That's it.
Is
that's
that what
it.
You set out to do?
No, I set out to tell the story of the Sai family. But I think that, you know, there's a wonderful essay called Self-Reliance, in which Emerson writes that a mark of genius is to know that what is true for you is true for all men. And I think that that's, genius or not, I think that's the novelist's gamble, that you can tell a small story, you can tell a story about six people, Kwaku, Fola, Olu, Taiwo, Fende, and Sadie, and yet complete strangers all around the world will be able to see themselves in those characters.
But it must have been very brave for you to, because some of the things in the book seem to point to your own typical upbringing, and yet you were bold enough to put that in a book, of course, with different names. But this was really you were writing about.
No, I disagree. Yes and no.
Part of this.
Any novelist is putting herself or himself in the novel. Mm. No way to avoid it. But the autobiographical details that one finds in Ghana Must Go, and they are many and they are obvious, to me are details. The father, comes from Ghana because my father's from Ghana. He's a surgeon because my father's a surgeon. The mom, Fola, is Nigerian and Scottish because my mom, Dr. Juliet, is Nigerian and Scottish. Okay, all true.
Fine.
Olu goes to Harvard and Johns Hopkins, yes, and my twin, the same. But this is because I know these places, okay. And I know these things.
Okay.
When we look one level below that, never mind where they're from, where they went to school, the streets that they drive on, and so forth, who are these people? Who are their personalities? What motivates them? What scares them? What makes them love? These characters are not my family members.
Certainly not. There. Very interesting title to choose, looking at their history. I'm sure it wasn't difficult, was it?
No, you know, I was in Ghana. I was in my mother's garden. Because when you quit your job and you have no money, the first thing you should do, note to all aspiring writers, is move back home.
Yeah.
Especially if your mom can cook like mine.
Wow.
So there I was in her garden, chomping down on some egusi soup. And I needed a name. I needed to give the document. It was about 50 pages long at that point. I needed to give it a name. And the name that arose in my heart was Ghana Must Go. I shared it with my mom. She said, that's a bit controversial. You know, being a Nigerian living in Ghana, she's very sensitive to
exactly.
Peculiarities of our
cousin
relationship. Okay, like this. And so she said, I don't know. And I said, but mom, that's the title that was in my heart. Just like Sex Lives of African Girls or whatever. I named my pieces right away and I never changed the title. So this is it.
I'm even surprised Ghana and Nigeria haven't gone to World War II fighting for you. Because you have avoided that conflict.
There's something. There's a Taiye for the Yoruba, the Selasi for the Ewe, and there's something for everyone.
Certainly, certainly. We're talking to the great Taiye Selasi, author of the book Ghana Must Go, which you must get. I understand somebody bought the book even when it was only at 100 pages. That's how big this is. But I guess what made this book so great for people, even before it came out, was the essay on who you actually were, the Afropolitan one.
Yeah.
Because I know lots of people who identify with the struggle you described to the Guardian newspaper.
Right.
Where are you from?
Right, right.
So tell me about that.
Sure. In 2005, I wrote this essay, La Baba Ba, What is an Afropolitan? And I wrote it. Many people think I was trying to invent an identity. I really wasn't. I was just trying to come to terms with the fact that I didn't seem to have one. You know, so when I'm in Ghana, despite the fact that I have my Taiye Selasi, no, you know, people say, you're not really Ghanaian because look at your big hair and your big Christy Brown necklace. You know, you're something else. Same in Nigeria. When I'm in America, it's a very racist country still, let's be frank. And so as a black woman, I've never felt fully American. And one need only look at what's happening there in the justice system to see why. Mm-hmm. And the same in England. So I've got an American passport, I've got a British passport, I've got a Nigerian mom, and I've got a Ghanaian father, but never was I able to simply say, I am X. And so in 2005, as you do when you're leaving grad school, I said, well, I'm writing an essay about it. And I thought that would be the end of it. And I was, you can't imagine how happy I was when I started getting these emails from people in Kenya and South Africa, and even in Egypt, in India, saying, that's my experience too. I can never just say, I am X and leave it at that. And that's what I was describing, the experience that gave rise to the identity, which has now given rise to the mentality, which I think of as African-American.
Mm. You say you don't set out to do anything when you write, but it's very evident, it's almost like poetic prose. You're very poetic.
You know, my father, Bakalari Wilson, has published poetry.
Actually.
The producer said he read my father's poems.
Okay.
So maybe it's a question.
Chip of the old block.
That's it. Like father, like daughter.
But did you study poetry? You did not?
Just my father.
Oh, wow. Because it's very evident in your style. It's almost like a poem, a long poem you're writing.
Indeed.
And it comes effortlessly.
It does.
Unbelievable. Now, I'm going to give a few, my colleagues will ask you a few questions, but just something you said before we came on air that's caught my attention. Now, we organized an essay competition, and I did mention that this is for 10 to 14-year-olds. And are you saying you wrote an essay at 12 similar to this topic?
When you said that, my heart leapt, because when I was 12, I had the opportunity to participate in almost exactly the same type of contest. Instead of writing about children with disabilities, I was writing about children with illiteracy. That was the prompt.
Okay.
To write something, an essay about what life would be like if I couldn't read. And my twin sister, Yasa Tawafi, she worked with the disabled population of Ghana. So when you said
came
very close to
struck
me.
A chord.
But I thought to myself, wow, when I was 12, I wrote that essay, we sent it off, it won. I got the mayor, the minister of the town, gave me a key to the city. And I'll never forget when I was standing there having my picture taken for the local newspaper.
Oh, wow.
I thought to myself, all of this happened because I dared. I tried. I wrote, which is what I love to do, and this is what I want to do for the rest of my life. And now, 20 years later, I don't know if I should have met that on air. I think back to that time when I was 12. I think back to that essay, and I encourage any young person in Ghana, 10 to 14, who's interested in this right away contest to do it.
You are a
because
superstar.
You never know where you'll end up.
I couldn't pay you for this. Taiye Selasi says, right. Right. You will become like her. Okay, try it.
You know, for me, this is fantastic. Just listening to the stuff that you've done and do and like to do, it's amazing because I'm a bit like that. I think I live life. Bernard will ask me, you do so many different things. And I always say, I just live life.
Yeah.
It's great to just tap into that inner self and try various different things.
And your blessings.
Exactly.
And to say, well, you know, these things were placed within me.
Fantastic.
I didn't go to the store and buy writing talent.
So for me, I just yesterday started learning English literature all over again. And I'm falling in love with writing. And so I was so very much looking forward to meeting you and sort of reading a bit about you and your books. Now, what are the things that you look to for inspiration when you have to write a piece, be it an essay or a book?
I love that question because the answer is music. When I need to get into the space, and it's funny with articles, it's even more urgent because there's always a deadline and it's short. And so when I need to go to that place, whence the words may flow, it's always music. I always
What genre?
Every kind of music. I listen to everything. I love the traditional music from Mali. I love King Sonny Ade. I love classical music. I love Tchaikovsky. I love rock.
Wow.
I love jazz. I love pop. I love Azonto.
Hey, my love. I guess you read as voraciously as you enjoy music. What do you read or what are your favorite?
Same thing. It just everything and anything. I love lyrical prose. So okay. I'll take Amata Idu on the one hand. I'll take The Beautiful Ones Are Not Yet Born. I love Nabokov. I love Penelope Lively, a British writer. I love Chimamanda Adichie. I love Zadie Smith. I love Teju Cole. You might be my favorite writer at the moment, the Nigerian author.
Writing is hard. We try to write. And
it's the hardest thing on earth, trust me.
And I think it is hard. So most people, most Ghanaian young adults, is like, no go area. I'd rather get a job than write. Is there something to them,
Yeah, it is hard, and like anything that is difficult and worthwhile, it's only worth doing if you love it. You know, I had that wonderful opportunity to go on one, and we were talking about switching careers, and I loved what the gentleman said, because he said the first thing you have to have is not the money, it's not the backing, it's the passion. Because when the going gets rough, it's only that passion that's going to get you through. I suffered a 6-month writer's block in the middle of writing that on my soul. Really awkwardly timed writer's block.
Six months.
I was living in New York. I left New York. I moved to Rome, Italy, where I live now. I was doing yoga. I was doing meditation. I was on the phone with my father in Saudi Arabia doing chants.
It wasn't working.
Nothing.
How did you snap out of it?
I realized what the problem was, and I was scared.
Oh.
And I think that what I finally realized was I had signed this book deal with 100 pages. It was a huge blessing, and I thought I would just sit down and finish the book. But I got scared. I thought to myself, every sentence I wrote seemed insufficient. It wasn't worth the contract. It wasn't worth the hype. It wasn't worth Professor Morrison's help. It wasn't worth, I really started to, I just got scared.
And went through a period of self-doubt.
I mean,
God.
And how, and what I realized was that the opposite of fear is love.
Mm.
And what I needed to do in order to overcome that fear was to go back to the pure love that I've always had for words, for writing. And I did.
That's great to hear. But there's, I was listening to an interview of the man who recently died. Things Fall Apart.
Chinua
Achebe.
Show a little respect to my Nigerian brethren, for you young ladies. Show a modicum.
And there's something that he said about not being able to teach creative writing.
Yeah.
For me, I write, and I think it's serious. But when it comes to creative writing, I'm like, this is not my area. I mean, I cannot piece it. So is it important for you to take a class, to just go with the flow?
You know, I understand what the late, great Professor Achebe meant. Professor Morrison says the same thing, that you can't teach someone how to write creatively. You've got to have you've got to have that sort of creative bone in your body, which then will express itself in whichever way. And I think that is true to a certain extent. But there is such a thing as technique.
Okay.
I think you can take someone who has the inclination, who has the love, the passion, and the boldness, and you can teach that person, listen, don't start the sentence with a preposition. Or if you do, do it stylistically. And maybe this is a lovely paragraph, but you've gone on a bit too long, which is sometimes my challenge. Or this is a lovely metaphor, but it's a bit too abstract. These things can be taught because they need to be considered. Mm. So I don't like the idea that you might say to a young person, you're not a writer and you never will be. You never know. You have to. I think one has to do the most that one can to encourage young people to express their creativity.
Mm.
You can't give them the courage to pursue it, but you have to encourage them to express it.
All right, read a couple of questions from the public. This is Alicia Keys, Girl on Fire. Hope you're enjoying this. Good. So, can you get in here?
She got all through the clouds, and she's not breaking down. This girl is on fire. This girl is on fire. She's walking on fire.
Yes, sir.
This girl is on fire.
So.
Yoruba. Taiye. I've actually interviewed your father in his house. Yes, I have. He's an old student of Bisek. So he came down once and I came to his house to interview him on some stuff.
In Abilene Pool?
Yes, some house in Abilene Pool.
Yeah.
I have his have this book.
Wow.
So father and daughter.
It's important also for the new family to pass things on to their children.
This girl's plane is on fire. She is the lovely Taiye Selasi. And I know very soon there will be a diplomatic row because Ghana will make a statement that, oh, this lady is from Ghana, Nigeria, Bakassi Peninsula, that kind of thing. Meanwhile, there's an interesting question from Leroy. She says, one of my favorite sayings is that if you don't have the time to read, you don't have the tools to write. Now, he wants you to comment on that in view of the fact that lots of Ghanaian kids aren't finding time to read. Is this true, dude? Is this?
It's absolutely right. I mean, there's no book written on creative writing, to your point of, there's no book written on creative writing that doesn't say it. The best way to learn how to write is to read, hands down. I read everything as a child, and it breaks my heart to see young people now, not just in Ghana, always on their phones, always in front of a screen of some kind. You know, parents, my mom's a pediatrician, and she always says, you have to take those devices out of your children's hands and give them a book. And I've got these wonderful godchildren in India, and in order to get the Wi-Fi password for the day, they have to read something. Come tell me what it's about. And then you can go online, then you can play video games. It's of the utmost importance that young people and old people and everyone in between read books.
Read books, says the great Taiye Selasi. What's your schedule? You did a couple of readings.
I did. I had an amazing event at Taverna Tropicana. I've never seen anything like it in Accra. We had George Wabbit singing, Minu, Sewa played, Kobe Graham hosted. Then last night we had an amazing launch at Villa Monticello. I was so honored by the literary greats that came, and the American ambassador was there. It was just
Are we convinced amazing. You enough to stay here permanently?
Yeah, I'm thinking about it. In fact, when I leave here, I'm going to look at a house.
you're right. You're very complimentary of Accra in your writing. Most people who live here don't like, I mean, it's maybe because
careful,
you travel.
Careful.
Let me rephrase the question. You travel all over the world, and you like Accra.
I love it.
Well, lots of things don't work here.
They don't.
Yes, but you still manage to see the positive side.
I do.
That's, of course, traveling gives you a sense of perspective.
Absolutely. I mean, I live in Rome right now, and people romanticize it. It's so wonderful. The food is so wonderful. People are so friendly. The food is so good. It's all true.
Mm-hmm.
The government is non-functional. There was a senator the other day that made a blatantly racist remark and hasn't apologized.
Mm-hmm.
Regularly, when I first got there, my landlord said to me, I've returned your deposit that you sent us. I said, is anything wrong? She said, no, we just prefer to take all of our payments in cash. Okay, so tax evasion, left, right, and center. It doesn't work, but that doesn't mean that it's not wonderful.
Okay.
And so when I'm in Accra, it's the same thing. The food is amazing. The people are wonderful. The weather right now is great. There's a sense of possibility across in many ways. A young city, it's happening. It's achieving itself in front of our very eyes. And so instead of looking at what doesn't work, I say, let's celebrate what does and try to fix what doesn't. Enough with the complaining.
I know you'll be at a Yale program later today.
I shall.
Do you see yourself as part of a certain solution? Because that conference is really about trying to think of new ways helping Africa to move as quickly as possible. Are you just a writer, or do you see a bigger picture in terms of doing something for Africa?
Yeah, I said it last night. I think that the role of a novelist is to ask the questions more so than to end them. But I think that the asking of the questions, the raising of the issues, the confrontation of the truths is a step in that process. Is it the only step? Absolutely not. That's why I'm always willing to participate with policymakers. You know, my family, I come from a medical family, but even my father is a surgeon and a poet. My mother is a pediatrician and a horticulturalist. My twin sister is a sports medicine doctor and an athlete. And so like you know, we do a lot of things. And I say that to say that all hands on deck. When I think about how Ghana will move, and it is, will continue to move into its bright, rapidly approaching future, I think we all need to be involved.
Mm-hmm.
And the idea that it can only be the old guard, it can only be politicians, this is antiquated and it's errant.
I love that. I love that. Where can we get? Is it out? Is the book out?
Ghana Must Go is out.
Okay.
So books will be available next week, both through Accra Premium and at Omni Clinic, where my mom has her practice.
Omni Clinic.
Yes,
great.
Hot off the presses.
Brilliant. This is a book you must get. Taiye, it's been really, really great having you.
Completely my pleasure. I can see why my dad loved it to be interviewed.
Yes, indeed. Big ups to Nicole, producer par excellence, for this segment. Yeah. When we come back, it's going back to the Supreme Court. Yes. Please. Please. Philip, Philip. Before everybody starts rushing, yeah, yeah, yeah. Let me just take one with this. Just one. Just a beautiful shot for my Twitter feed. Okay. I hope my hand is not too big. Okay, good.